When we think about the idea of time, or time as a concept in film, we invariably think of Christopher Nolan. So goes the joke that Nolan looks at time the same way Tarantino looks at feet. This is to say, a fetish, an obsession, a desire to frame it in cinematic terms. While it's true that Nolan has used time as a cinematic tool like no other, there's another filmmaker who thinks a lot about that all-elusive concept, the American master craftsman Michael Mann. Mann's a descendant of the John Frankenheimer school of filmmaking. He's a sort of poet bodybuilder, someone who makes muscular and masculine films that nonetheless have a deep poetic soul coursing through their veins. In the midst of violent and bloody robberies, wild speedboat chases, nightclub shootouts, high-value thefts, and nuclear reactor explosions, there's the concept of time dictating pace, dictating character, dictating the film's innermost value. After all, what is time if not a product or a reflection of the soul? And that's what Mann's really interested in. So today, let's take a look at a couple of examples of how Michael Mann uses time as a character, the same way New York is a character in Taxi Driver, or Los Angeles a character in Drive, and also how it becomes a character trait, something that defines Mann's protagonists. Let's dive into Michael Mann's time. In Mann's fever dream big screen debut, Thief, James Caan plays Frank, a professional robber of cash and diamonds who feels like life isn't within his grasp any longer, that he has lost time. The only way he can get it back is through scores, a feeling akin to that of an adrenaline junkie who sticks to extreme situations to feel the present more intensely. Frank says it clearly in one of the film's most affecting and expertly shot sequences.
Look, I have run out of time. I have lost it all. And so I can't work fast enough to catch up, and I can't run fast enough to catch up, and the only thing that catches me up is doing my magic act.
Frank knows that the job will eventually end, and now he starts projecting onto the future. He looks at his vision board, the symbol of a paradise that may never come, and suddenly finds the urge to get there, and fast. Why? Well, first his mentor, played with gusto by Willie Nelson, has only a few more months to live, meaning he's running out of time. Secondly, Frank's previous marriage failed and the window to establish a legacy is closing. Third, he's getting older. Time is noticeable in his own skin. So how to curb time? That's the question that Frank and by proxy Michael Mann are obsessed with. Let's go back to that diner sequence, more specifically the beginning, when Jessie, played by Tuesday Weld, is talking about why she's hesitant to be in a relationship with Frank and change her life. She talks about her previous marriage.
It ended very badly.
And then she says,
now I get up in the morning, I take a shower, I go to work, I have a job, I have a social security card, and my life is very ordinary, very boring, which is good because it's solid.
Jessie has found some semblance of control in her life, and that's exactly what triggers Frank, who fires back at her like someone who's attacking his own image, someone who desperately craves change and wants to enact it but needs someone by his side to do so.
You're marking time is what you are. You're backing off, you're hiding out, you're waiting for a bus that you hope never comes because you don't want to get on anyway because you don't want to go anywhere, all right?
What follows is that much coveted change. Frank and Jessie get married and quite literally get a kid. But they also get tied down to circumstances pertaining to Frank's job, which is to say, pertaining to his obsession to curb time, to cheat it, to get what he wants to get faster than time allows for. That's why the film's climax is so heartbreaking. Frank loses control and yet again he's forced back to the present. He can't project onto the future any longer, because what's happening around him is real. It's a life or death situation that requires all of his attention, all of his presence, all of his time. In a not-so-kind article for The New Yorker, Richard Brody nonetheless wrote something insightful about Michael Mann. Mann's movies are distinguished from less sophisticated and more conventional modes of realism by the feeling that they're not like film screenplays but like film blueprints, filmed armatures. But Mann believes deeply in the reality of his subjects and characters nonetheless, and he allows for no breaks, no faults, no fractures, no excesses, no loose ends, no figures or turns to stand out from the precisely calibrated design. This is to say, Mann's obsessed with control. And doesn't it make complete sense? Why wouldn't he be so fixated on time as a concept, since it's the one thing he can't exert control over? Except, of course, within his own movies, within the realities he creates. Perhaps because of an attempt to come to grips with his truth, Mann's characters tend to have a pragmatic and contentious approach to the concept of time and its impact. Take Chris Hemsworth's Nick Hathaway in Black Hat. Nick's a hacker who's been in prison for a long time and is released only to help American and Chinese authorities pursue a mysterious cyber criminal.
I did the crime, I'm doing the time, time isn't doing me.
Even when circumstances dictate a bigger truth, Mann rebels against it by giving his characters a personal code.
I do my own time, not the institutions. See, to hold on to who you are in there, you dedicate yourself to your program. You work out in your body and your mind.
Noble in theory, but the problem is that Nick believes he's still in prison, and so he still has a prison mentality. For a man who wants to be liberated by time, he sure feels imprisoned by it. The same could be said about Robert De Niro's Neil McCauley in Heat. In his world-famous speech, Neil talks about the cost of his lifestyle.
Guy told me one time, don't let yourself get attached to anything you are not willing to walk out on in 30 seconds flat if you feel the heat around a corner.
Notice that he specifies the time, the exact time, 30 seconds. That's how long it's going to take him to leave everything and everyone behind in pursuit of continued liberation. Simultaneously, however, he's completely inflexible and imprisoned by his mentality. Because it means sacrifice, it means that everything that's good comes at a cost, something that Mann further proves by having Neil breaking his own rule in service of the attachments he created, which ultimately lead to his demise. It's grim because it feels like there's no way out. And he's right in a way. There's no escaping time, only writing it. And his characters try again and again to cheat it, to go around it, to transcend it, but there's only one truth, one that can be found in multiple Mann movies, and that's that...
Whatever time you get is luck.
I said, time is luck.
But what happens when the nature of the narrative forces Mann's characters and Mann himself to have to bend to the desires of time itself? When they're not trying to cheat it because they can't, because they have to wait. Well, look no further than 1986's Manhunter, the first film to adapt a Richard Harris novel and the first to introduce Hannibal Lecter into the pop culture lexicon. In it, time functions as both a narrative device and as an obsession. Will Graham, played with remarkable restraint by William Peterson, is racing against the clock to prevent the Tooth Fairy's next killing, which he knows will happen in 3 weeks and 3 days. That's when the next full moon will take place. Turns out that the serial killer is on the lunar cycle. The issue for Graham is that he has to work the case, and that means an emphasis on forensic minutiae. That also means spending time, precious time. Graham is in many ways a slave to it. He knows it's passing faster than he wishes it would, but also knows that time needs to run its course in order to get where he wants to get. There are two forces working in different directions, and eventually they'll meet in the middle. Graham just hopes it's not too late, that he didn't miscalculate time. In order to deconstruct this journey, Mann engages the viewer at an intellectual level, letting him on every step of the process, bringing him along on a highly immersive and disturbing journey. It's precise and methodical and has one ultimate goal, to make you feel the passage of time. But in a surprising and deeply soulful turn, Mann uses the opportunity to equate time with love, throwing a curveball at Graham's personal life. This helps cement Graham's conflicted feelings towards his job. On the one hand, he's obsessed with it and needs to see it through. On the other, he knows that the time he's dedicating to the Tooth Fairy is time that he's losing with his wife, with his child. And that means not only losing time, but also seeing love fade away. In an ironic twist of fate, love is also what the Tooth Fairy is searching for. So Manhunter juxtaposes two very different men who both follow their most intimate desires and obsessions, except one force is rooted in good and the other in evil. The issue for Graham is that for him to get back to love, he needs to become the person he's hunting. Mann understood that the dichotomy between time and love is inescapable 30 years before Christopher Nolan did, and used it to masterfully build an existential work of art. Time has no less weight in other Mann films, from Public Enemies and Ali to Collateral, The Last of the Mohicans, and even The Keep. In all, a deeper reading can be made about how time defines these narratives and the complex and vivid characters that populate them. Ultimately, the truth is that more than cops and robbers, more than the City of Angels in all its glorious cynicism, more than the vast ocean as a reflection of the desire for freedom, even more than the color blue, it's time that defines Mann's filmography. Time is luck, time runs out, time is lost, time is gained, time is everything, and Mann knows it.